So we've been talking about data flow analysis in a lot of detail. We looked at some examples of data flow analysis, then we looked at a framework, and then we looked at some complex analysis like lazy code motion based on data flow analysis. So why did we discuss data flow analysis in so much detail? Well, because it's one of the most important and fundamental techniques in static program analysis. And while we've been discussing about it in the context of compiler optimization, it actually has more applications than just compiler optimization. One of the applications of data flow analysis is software verification. So just like we do, for example, constant propagation, it's just an analysis that we could either use for optimization or we could use for some properties that we want to ascertain about the program. For example, if there's an assertion at a particular program point that we want to make, for example, we want to make an assertion that x is always equal to 3, then something like that can be checked using data flow analysis. Of course, when we talk about software verification, the properties are not as simple as just x equals 3, but typically you're interested in checking more complex and more involved properties of the software. Similarly, there's another kind of technique and products based on that technique which are called anti-pattern detection. So what is an anti-pattern? An anti-pattern is a pattern that is kind of commonly present in software, but it is actually not a good pattern to have. So for example, it's a very common programming mistakes that you would malloc, you could call malloc to get a pointer to a newly allocated memory, but you would not check it against null before dereferencing it. And that's an error, because just in case malloc had failed, it would have returned a null pointer, and then if you dereference it, that would have caused a memory error, a segmentation fault. And so there are static analysis tools that will detect such anti-patterns. The malloc example I gave is just one example of an anti-pattern. You could have lots of such anti-patterns. There are some anti-patterns that are common across all programs in a certain language. There's some anti-patterns that are specific to a particular system being built. And so you can detect such anti-patterns using techniques similar to data flow analysis. Also, things like data flow analysis are very helpful for doing code mobility. So what do I mean by code mobility? Let's say I am a website and I want to send code to your browser, and you're going to run my code on your browser. So before you run my code, you can do some kind of data flow analysis to make sure that your code, the untrusted code that you downloaded on your browser, is not going to harm your computer in any way. All right. Similarly, there's a famous example of Berkeley packet filters, which is basically allows a user application to download code into the kernel mode and run it in the kernel mode. So what the kernel does is it implements some sort of a data flow analysis to check that the code that's been downloaded is safe to run, and then it runs it in kernel mode. Running it in kernel mode makes it faster than having to run it in user mode. And something like that is used for high-speed networking, and that's how the name packet filters comes along. So data flow analysis is a very powerful and very important and a very fundamental technique. But then when you have multiple data flow analysis, you often have situations where one DFA-based transformation enables another. And this is in the context of compiler optimization. So we've already seen examples where one DFA is based on another DFA. For example, we looked at lazy code motion. But also, one DFA-based transformation enables another. And this is very similar to our discussion in the beginning of optimization. We said one optimization enables another. And so the same thing actually holds for DFA-based optimizations or transformations as well. So here is an example. And this example, I call it deep common sub-expressions. So let's say I have a program where I have T1 equals A plus B and C equals T1 plus D. And then after some point, maybe at some other location, I have T2 equals A plus B and E equals T2 plus D. Now you can see that at this particular program point, A plus B is available in T1 because all the incoming paths both come through T1 equals A plus B. So A plus B is already available in T1. But if I look at the second expression here, it's T2 plus D, whereas in the first basic block, it was T1 plus D, and it doesn't seem like they are common. You know, textually T1 plus D and T2 plus D are different, and so our common sub-expression elimination will call them different and not be able to eliminate one of them. All right. So that's basically the idea. So how do we solve this problem? And so the point I'm going to make here is that if I just run common sub-expression elimination algorithm, as we know it, twice on this program, then we are going to, and maybe followed by, maybe interspersed with copy propagation, then we are going to be able to eliminate both the expressions A plus B and T1 plus D. So how does it work? Well, our first pass of common sub-expression elimination is going to eliminate A plus B, and so it's going to replace T2 equals A plus B with T2 equals T1. And then once we do that, then I'm going to do copy propagation, and so I'm going to replace T2 by T1 everywhere, and so that's what this code becomes. It becomes E equals T1 plus B. And now after I've done copy propagation, if I run common sub-expression again, you can see that T1 plus D is now common across the two programs, and so we have been able to achieve deep common sub-expression elimination, right? So if I, and the final step, I'll just remove E equals T1 plus D and replace it with E equals C. All right, so that's an example where the same transformation, or actually common sub-expression elimination and copy propagation followed by common sub-expression elimination, yielded us deep common sub-expression elimination. Here is another example of DFA interaction. Let's say I have x equals 10, then I say x greater than 0, y equals 20 on one branch, y equals y plus a on the other branch, and there's a loop. And then at the end, at the midpoint, we have z equals y. So notice that I'm setting x equals 10, I'm checking x is greater than 0, which is always going to evaluate to true in the first iteration. So let's do constant propagation here. So if I do constant propagation, then I would be able to identify that this condition x is greater than 0 may or may not, I'm going to be able to identify that on all the incoming paths x equals 10, right? Because here I'm not actually modifying x anywhere, so x is equal to 10, and so I would be able to replace x greater than 0 with false, right? So I'm going to be able to replace this with false, and so with true, and when I replace it with true, then I can just get rid of this other branch, including the loop, because I know that it's not even reachable. So that's what I'm going to show. So after constant propagation, I'm able to get 10 is greater than 0, which is just true. And so based on that, if I can do dead code elimination, so after dead code elimination, I just get rid of one branch of this condition block, right? And so based on that, once again, based on that, if I do common constant propagation again, then I will be able to replace z equals y with z equals 20, right? Whereas in the original program, I wouldn't have been able to do that, because if I do constant propagation on this program, then on the incoming path, on one path, I see that y equals 20, but on the other path, y equals y plus a, which is not a constant, right? So I'm going to not be able to replace z equals y with z equals 20. But after I do dead code elimination, now if I do constant propagation, then I'm able to replace z equals y with z equals 20. This should be 20. Okay. All right. So once again, constant propagation followed by dead code elimination and then constant propagation again in this particular example yielded me a better result than if I hadn't done things in this particular sequence. So these were both examples that I showed of interactions of DFA analysis involved constructive interference, which means one analysis was enabling another analysis. There are also examples of destructive DFA interference. So for example, this is our well-known strength reduction example. So let's say I have T equals 2 into A and B equals 3 into T. Now I can potentially implement constant folding using common sub-expression elimination, and I can say, okay, I can just replace B equals 3 into T with B equals 6 into A, right? And I can just get rid of, let's say, T. Now, assuming T is not live apart from at this statement. Now, if I can do this kind of constant folding only if I know that both of them are multiplications and they are multiplications to constants. But if I do strength reduction first, then what I'll do is I'll replace T equals 2 into A with T equals A left shifted by 1. And once I do this, then it becomes much harder to identify the pattern that something that is left shifted by 1 and then multiplied by 3 is the same as saying that it multiplied by 6, all right? So it is possible to implement even such analysis, but the point is that whatever analysis we implement, it will have some limitations. And in this case, I am assuming that the constant folding has a limitation that it can only fold multiplications, not a shift with a multiplication. And so So I'm not going to be able to go from this program to this program. On the other hand, if I had done constant folding first, then I would have just eliminated T equals 2 into A and just had B equals 6 into A. So constant folding and let's say plus dead code elimination would have given me this, right? And so if I had done this first, then I would have gotten this answer, which is a good answer. Which if I had done strength reduction first, then I won't be able to go from here to here because my analysis is not powerful enough to identify such patterns. So while DF data flow analysis based transformations may often interfere constructively, sometimes they may also interfere destructively. So this is the well-known phase ordering problem, which means if two or more transformations are mutually interfering, the order of their execution may be consequential. And the phase ordering problem is basically the problem that what is the best order in to arrange these transformations in. We have already seen examples where one transformation may enable another transformation, and we have also seen an example where one transformation may disable another transformation. Now the phase ordering problem is a hard problem in terms of computational tractability, and so solving it precisely is not possible in polynomial time or efficiently. And so typically what people do is either they, you know, carefully engineer the pipeline of transformation passes, DFA based transformation passes that should be executed in a compiler, and that's the order in which they happen. Often the same transformation pass is repeats in that pipeline also. For example, common sub expression may be eliminated, may be executed twice in that pipeline. For example, some examples we saw required that, or copy propagation is executed multiple times. Also, there is another approach which is that you run a meta fixed point loop in which you kind of apply these transformations in some predefined order, and you keep executing that meta fixed point loop until the program stops changing. And this assumes that the program is changing in a particular direction, so this algorithm will eventually reach a fixed point and will not diverge, it will converge. The second approach is less practical, because potentially the compiler can run for a long time to reach the fixed point, but it is also an option, and it is an efficient option in the sense that it's not, at least not an exponential time algorithm to figure out the best possible answer. There have been some other approaches to also solve the phase ordering problem, which involve trying to identify all possible orders, but doing so efficiently. And that is something that has, you know, that has appeared in a lot of research literature, but that is outside the scope of our discussion.